plumberparts.co.uk. Honest reviews and advice.
Hello, my name's James and welcome to today's plumberparts.co.uk video. What we're going to look at in these next few videos, we're going to do this in a couple of stages, is the installation of a stapled underfloor heating system that's going to be covered over by a nice 75mm screed and then tiled, and then all the kitchen's going to get installed after that, and hopefully we'll show you the finished product and it's going to look brilliant. But that might take a little while. This is my house. I'm just doing it as and when between plumbing jobs and doing the brilliance that is plumberparts. So what I'm first going to show you is the room itself. What we've got behind us is basically a 5 meter squared room, and because we've got kitchen units going in, we don't want to put underfloor heating underneath those kitchen units. So that's the first thing we want to measure out, which are the places where we don't want to put underfloor heating. Secondly, what we need to figure out is how many loops we have. Now, I contacted Wavin's technical service, you can do that too through their website, and they will basically tell you or show you a floor plan of exactly what you want to do. Now, because this room is so small, what we're going to need is two loops. So that's two single circuits that zigzag around the floor, heating up the screed and then going back to the manifold again. Now we also need to know is, where are we actually going to site our manifold? Now there are a few things you need to think about when you come to do this. Number one, you need to have a very, very easy way of getting the flow and return from the main heating system into your manifold. Number two, you need to make sure that your manifold is always fully accessible, so it's in a nice little cupboard. And number three, you need to make sure that it's easy for you to get your controls back to the manifold, so it's easy to wire it all up when it's finished. So let's have a look at where we could put this manifold. Now, I know that just on the other side of this wall here, we've got a small toilet. But in this corner here, we've got a 500 wide larder unit coming in, and also a large American-ish fridge freezer, if I can afford it, which I don't think I can. She wants it though. So basically, I know that I can't put my manifold in here because there's going to be stuff in the way. Some people would like chase out some brick, put a small lintel in and try and hide their manifold in there. But that's going to be difficult because we know that our larder unit's going to be going in. But next door in the toilet, there's a boxed in area above the toilet itself where I know that I can put my manifold. And you know what? The best thing as well is that the two fly and return primary pipes from the boiler run through that toilet space as well. So number one, then I know that I've got the first thing, which is the flow and return. I can run my pipes up through here, my two loops that can go around and out here. That's gonna be really easy. And also I know it's gonna be really easy to wire it up, and it's gonna be accessible. So that's the perfect place. The thing is now is to have a look at the manifold itself, and I'll give you a brief overview of Wavin's twist, click and lock system that they use for their manifolds. So then let's have a look at the basis of how the Wavin manifold works. We've got our flow in from the boiler that comes in from this pipe here that's got the red valve on it and also an arrow pointing in there. Then it goes through this mixing valve here, because different types of floor, like a wooden floor or a screed floor or something like that, need different temperatures of underfloor heating water to be going through it. Then it goes through this little pump here, then straight through up into this part here. Now this is the great bit about the twist, click and lock system. If we take a closer look, now all we need to do when we add a port on is to pop it on like so, and then that clicks into position like that. Then you've got your flow adjuster here. Now the great thing about this particular system is okay, I've got two loops on this one here at the moment, but if I want to put underfloor heating into my living room or into a porch out the front, then all I need to do is buy the extra ports and I can actually add them on, as long as I've got enough room where I've actually installed the manifold itself. So that is the really good benefit of the twist, click and lock system that Wavin do. So now I'm gonna have another one of these on here because I've got two loops. So I'm just gonna twist that up now and pop, lock that into place. And then I've got a blanking cap here, just like that. You can go over there. And then our manifold is pretty much ready to be installed on the wall. Right, so here we are in the little loo that's adjacent to the kitchen that's just next door there. We've had to put our manifold in here because of the reasons I explained a minute ago. And also I've had to set the manifold off the wall a little bit with a bit of 4x2 so the heat and flow and return pipes can pass underneath there. If I need to add another loop on, I've got enough room here. The reason I've left it over where it is because sometimes you might need to take this probe out here and you're gonna need that much length there to be able to get that probe out. We've got our flow and return from the heating system here. The boiler's just through there. It's kind of a temporary install at the moment while other work's going on in the house, because there is gonna be a side extension going on, but for the purposes of this video this is going to be fine. What we're going to do is we're going to ascertain which ones are flow and return. We're going to pipe into these two here like that, and then everything should be okay to run. But before we do that, I'm actually going to mark out where the kitchen units are going to be in the kitchen and then staple out our pipes and then bring them back up in here into our manifold, because they're going to be tucked around out here out of the way before we put any more pipework in front of it. Right, so we're in the corner at the moment where our two pipes are going to come through. Now, the first thing we know is that the screed height is going to be 75mm from the Celotex level. So I can't ever drill my holes any higher than that. So if I go down here, I'm going to make a mark as low as possible, really. Just along there on that brick there. So the next thing I need to know is that in this corner here, like I said, we've got a 500 by 630 deep larder, and then also an American fridge freezer that's going to be slightly bigger. And we don't want any of the underfloor heating to be there. So first thing I'm going to do is measure out 630, which is just here on the floor. And then I'm going to measure out 500, which is just there. And then I've got another 1,000 as well for the fridge freezer. And the fridge freezer sticks out a little bit more as well, so that sticks out 700. And then I know now that I've got an area here where I don't want any underfloor heating pipes. What I'm going to do is very quickly go around the rest of the kitchen as well and follow the drawing that we've got and basically mark out all the areas where I don't want to put my underfloor heating pipes. And then I can figure out quickly which way I want my loops to run and also how long they should be. But the next thing I'm going to do right now is just get my holes drilled back into that toilet so I know that I'll get my loops back up there and into my manifold. So we've got our four holes for our two flows and two returns basically drilled through into that little cupboard below where the manifold's going to be. What we need to do is basically get our first pipe pushed through and pretty much connected up to the manifold, or at least to the point where you know you've got enough pipe to cut off. Before pushing pipes through any holes in the wall, it's always worth just popping a bit of gaffer tape or some sort of protection over it to stop any debris going into the pipe. And always comply with local building regs as well when it comes to whether you need to sheath the pipe as it goes through the wall or not. We've just got small copper sheaths in here at the moment. So what I'm going to do now is push this pipe through this nearest one here, and then I can actually start to lay out my loop following the template that I've drawn on the floor according to the technical drawing of the kitchen. So I'm just going to pop this through here. I have to go next door and pull it up to the manifold. So now we use special staples that Waven supply with their underfloor heating system. Usually you get a good little gun as well for these, but I've mislaid mine. So I'm going to have to do this by hand, which is really annoying. It's one of those things. But so what I'm going to do is I'm going to do my first one. I'm just going to go along the edge like this and then back round. Leave a tiny little gap, because when we've done this, we're going to have to put in a small blue expansion foam outer that will actually stop any of the heat escaping into the wall from the screed. And also, if there's any expansion as well, it will take that up too. So I'm going to get on and do that now. You can watch that in quick motion stuff. And also, you should take note that I've avoided that area in the corner there that we marked out. Then we'll switch around and you can have a look at us doing this bit down here, where we've got the U part of all the sink bits and the island in the middle. Right, so there you go. As you can see behind me, we've now got the first loop of underfloor heating in. So if we look over there, you can see that our first one goes round here, and basically the underfloor heating then zigzags along behind me, whoop, all the way down there, and then basically goes back into the hole that it came out of and joins up back at the manifold. So now, with the help of my lovely wife here, who's in a grump, because today it's our anniversary, we're now going to get the other loop installed, which runs around in between the units around here and then back to our manifold. So I hope you enjoy watching that as well. Right, so there we go, we're now fully all in. As you can see, we've left a gap there for our little breakfast bar bit, and also we've got a gap that goes all the way around the outside for the units that go there. Ignore this white pipe going across here, that is just going to our beautiful temporary kitchen that we've got over there.
Right, so now that we've got all that down and in, rather than going back into where the little manifold's going to be and finishing off on my pipework, I'm just going to quickly go around and put our expanding foam on. It's basically got a little sticky back to it. It's supplied by Waving when they do underfloor heating packs. And like I say, it's got a sticky back to it, and also you can rip off strips to make it of different heights, which is quite handy. So I'm going to go around and get that all stuck in now. Right, so there we go. We've now got all the underfloor heating stapled down. We've got our manifold hung on the wall. We've got our outside blue insulation and expansion strip put in. And basically, the next stage of the job is actually connecting up the manifold to the two loops that we've got here. Then we'll have to connect that manifold up to the heating system. So join us in our next underfloor heating video, and we'll show you how to do that bit. So I hope you found this first part of the video helpful and interesting. Remember to follow us on Twitter and on Facebook, where we post lots of photos and videos that you send us every week. And remember, until the next video goes out about this, to hold tight. See you later.
Plumberparts.co.uk. Honest reviews and advice.
Look at him. Look at that dog. He just loves a bit of underfloor heating, don't you, Jack? Sheep!